Discussion on acute limb ischemia. Classical clinical presentation of acute limb ischemia has been described as 6 phases of critical limb ischemia. 1. Pale. 2. Painful. 3. Pulseless. 4. Paralyzed. 5. Paraesthetic. 6. Perishing cold or poikilothermia. Impaired regulation of body temperature. The limb usually becomes cold in accordance with room temperature, which is usually colder than body temperature. Some call the first 5 ones as 5 P's of critical limb ischemia. Pallor is due to lack of blood supply. Pain is due to limb ischemia. Pulses are absent as expected due to the vascular occlusion. Paralysis is due to ischemia of motor nerves and muscles. Paraesthesia is due to involvement of the sensory nerves. Critical limb ischemia has dual importance of being severe disease process and association with cardiovascular disease risk. Rutherford classification has been used in the setting of acute limb ischemia. In category 1, the limb is viable, there is no neurological sign, and arterial sounds are audible on Doppler evaluation. Category 2 is viability threatened but reversible ischemia. This category is subdivided into 2A and 2B. 2A is marginally threatened with sensory loss, absent arterial sound on Doppler but audible venous sound. 2B is immediately threatened with some degree of muscle weakness, arterial sounds inaudible on Doppler and venous sounds audible. Category 3 is irreversible ischemia with paralysis, contracture and inaudible arterial and venous sounds on Doppler. 30% of patients with acute limb ischemia may require major amputation, defined as amputation above the ankle. Half of them can die in a year, mostly due to cardiovascular disease. The term major adverse limb events is considered in the setting of peripheral arterial disease and peripheral interventions. It includes major amputation, re-intervention which could be surgical or repeat angioplasty. Major amputation is defined as amputation above the ankle, amputation at the tarsometatarsal level, Lisfranc level or below is not considered as a failure of limb salvage. Major vascular re-interventions are thrombectomy, thrombolysis or major surgical procedure, new bypass graft, jump or interposition graft revision in the index limb. In the COMBUS trial, of the 128 patients who had a major adverse limb event, 20.5% had a vascular amputation in 1 year. The risk of hospitalization was 61.5% and that of death was 8.3%. These figures underline the significance of major adverse limb events in those with limb ischemia. Thromboembolectomy with a Fogarty catheter is the age-old treatment for acute limb ischemia. Usual protocol is surgical dissection and exposure of the common femoral artery, superficial femoral artery, or brachial arteries depending on the case. Supplementary distal access may be used when needed. Though the procedure is meant for Rutherford category 1 and 2, occasionally it may be indicated in category 3. This is to relieve ischemia and or restore blood flow to collaterals. Objective in that case is for achieving a more distal amputation, osteoarticular preservation and better rehabilitation. Among the 105 patients evaluated in the study, thromboembolectomy with a Fogarty catheter was performed in 73.3% of cases. Arterial reocclusion was more frequent in thrombosis cases as compared to embolic cases. Major amputations were less frequent among Rutherford class 1 patients as expected. Peripheral intra-arterial thrombolysis is an option for acute limb ischemia due to a thrombus. Cannulate the vessel and pass a guide wire across the thrombus before thrombolysis. Heparin is given intravenously as soon as the guide wire passes the thrombus. Catheter with multiple side holes is used for thrombolysis. Streptokinase is generally not used in view of bleeding complications. Either urokinase or tissue type plasminogen activator is used. Immediate success is achieved in 60 to 90% and 2-year patency up to 80%. One retrospective study reported on 71 patients with acute popliteal artery occlusion with a mean 6-day-old ischemic time before thrombolysis. Technical success was achieved in 90% and clinical success in 87% of cases. Of the 71 patients, 33 had embolic occlusion while 30 had thrombotic occlusions. There were no major bleeding complications. Complications expected with PIAT. Most common complication, 3 to 20% site bleed. Intracranial bleed can occur in 0.5 to 2%. 8% may develop myocardial infarction. A Cochrane review concluded that there is some evidence indicating that intra-arterial tissue plasminogen activator is more effective than intra-arterial streptokinase or intravenous tissue plasminogen activator in improving vessel patency in peripheral arterial occlusion. The conclusion was reached after evaluating 5 randomized controlled trials involving a total of 687 participants. Another method for PIAT is using a porous balloon with low pressure. Recanalization could be obtained in 13 of the 14 cases in this study, and the usage of fibrinolytic agent was low. The limb salvage rate 6 months after recanalization was 92%, and the mean stay in the monitored area was around 1 day. This method could reduce hemorrhagic risk in the elderly because of localized delivery of lower quantity of fibrinolytic agent. Data comparing ultrasound accelerated versus multi-hole infusion catheter for thrombolysis in acute limb ischemia has been published. There was no significant difference in mean infusion duration, volume of tissue plasminogen activator, or technical success rate between the two cohorts. No difference was noted in major limb loss, compartment syndrome, overall complication rate, and 30-day mortality between the two catheter systems in the study.